Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Shabbat shalom. Hallelujah. This week we are in Shoftim. And Shoftim means judges. But maybe, Tommy, if you would do the honour.
Yeah, thanks, Helen. No problem.
A little bit more about that, please.
Yeah, Shoftim, judges. That's the plural of Shafat. Shafat means judge. On all these related kind of descriptions. And where it says Shoftim and Shoftarim, that's the beginning, isn't it? It's the very first word, this Shoftim of the parsha. But it says Shoftim and Shoftarim. In other words, judges and guards, or judges and magistrates, we probably call them. It doesn't say explicitly, but this is most likely would have been Levites. Because the nation now had to be governed in a godly way. Yeah. And so justice had to be godly. You know, God's justice is righteous, and God's righteousness is just. You know, it doesn't say that it is the Levites, but must surely be the Levites. And where it says Shoftarim and Shoftarim, it wouldn't have been two different roles or two different jobs for different people. They would have done both jobs. You know, so the minor incidences and also the higher up ones, you know. And that's basically it, really. It's Shoftarim, which is the plural for Shafat, which is judge.
Thank you, brother. This week, in a nutshell, and I mean, it's massive, Shoftim. It's huge, and there's a lot of instructions and a lot of laws given this week. But what are we going to unpack this week? Instructions are given regarding the appointment of judges and officers in all the gates of Israel's habitations. Warnings are given forbidding the worship of heavenly hosts, as great detail regarding the consequences for this idolatrous act is handed out. Jehovah tells his people to diligently inquire regarding this abomination, as the worship of stars is strictly prohibited. And I want to unpack what this means for us as believers this week and how we see it in the modern day world today, because it's massive, it's huge, and unless you see it with the lens looking through the Torah in the spirit, you won't see how this subtle abomination has seeped into our schools and education systems and universities and curriculums and everything from movies and what we watch on telly and billboards and the most famous people in the world, Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. They all want to go to space. They all want to go to space. Everyone wants to be a spaceman. You know, it's all about getting high and elevation. So we're going to see what this is this week. We're going to unpack it properly. So we're going to jump straight into Deuteronomy 17, but we will come back to Deuteronomy 16 where it starts in the second half. So we're going to do something a little bit different this week. So Tom, if you could read Deuteronomy 17 for me, please, bro. And if you could read from verse 1 till the end, that would be great, bro. Thank you.
You shall not sacrifice to the Lord your God a bull or sheep which has any blemish or defect, for that is an abomination to the Lord your God. If there is found among you within any of your gates which the Lord your God gives you, a man or a woman who has been wicked in the sight of the Lord your God, in transgressing his covenant, who has gone and served other gods and worshipped them, either the sun or moon or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded, and it is told you, and you hear of it, then you shall inquire diligently. And if it is indeed true and certain, that such an abomination has been committed in Israel, then you shall bring out to your gates that man or woman who has committed that wicked thing, and shall stone to death that man or woman with stones. Whoever is deserving of death shall be put to death on the testimony of two or three witnesses. He shall not be put to death on the testimony of one witness. The hands of the witnesses shall be the first against him to put him to death, and afterwards the hands of all the people. So you shall put away the evil from among you. If a matter arises which is too hard for you to judge, between degrees of guilt or for bloodshed, between one judgment or another, or between one punishment or another, matters of controversy within your gates, then you shall arise and go up to the place which the Lord your God chooses. And you shall come to the priests, the Levites, and to the judge there in those days, and inquire of them. They shall pronounce upon you the sentence of judgment. You shall do according to the sentence which they pronounce upon you in that place which the Lord chooses. And you shall be careful to do according to all that they order you. According to the sentence of the Lord in which they instruct you, according to the judgments which they tell you, you shall do. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left from the sentence which they pronounce upon you. Now the man who acts presumptuously and will not heed the priest who stands to minister there before the Lord your God or the judge, that man shall die. So you shall put away the evil from Israel. And all the people shall hear and fear and no longer act presumptuously. When you come to the land which the Lord your God has given you, and possess it, and dwell in it, and say, I will set a king over me, like all the nations that are around me, you shall surely set a king over you, whom the Lord your God chooses. One from among your brethren you shall set as king over you. You may not set a foreigner over you, who is not your brother. But he shall not multiply horses for himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt to multiply horses. For the Lord has said to you, you shall not return that way again. Neither shall he multiply bars for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he greatly multiply silver and gold for himself. Also it shall be, when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write for himself a copy of this law in a book, from the one before the priests, the Levites, and it shall be with him, and he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, and be careful to observe all the words of this law and these statutes, that his heart may not be lifted above his brethren, that he may not turn aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left, and that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, he and his children in the midst of Israel.
Hallelujah. So some real challenging verses there, and I've studied in the past what the process and the death penalty was and putting away the evil from among you, and how this stoning process, though it was like quite barbaric, it actually points to Yeshua, who is the Aved, the stone that the builders reject, who becomes the rock and stone of stumbling for all them that fall upon him. And he is the one without sin who will come back and cast the first stone. And he is the ultimate Shoftim, he is the ultimate judge. I've studied that in the past, so once we come across them verses in the Torah and it's like, whoa, take him outside and blitz him with rocks, it's like, it's all related to Yeshua, who, for them that don't repent, you know, there will be a certain judgment that comes, you know what I mean, in the second death, which is huge. So this week, what I want to show is the worship of the heavenly hosts, because the Lord speaks about it. It's come up multiple times in Deuteronomy. And what I want to show is how this subtle form of worship has managed to seep its way into society, and it can be seen. And once we open our eyes to it and it's right there, you're not going to be able to unsee it. It's massive. This is what we read today, Deuteronomy 17, 2-3. If there is anyone found among you within your gates, which the Lord your God gives you, a man or a woman which has been wicked in the sight of the Lord, in transgressing his covenant, who has gone and served other gods and worshipped them, that being the sun, the moon, the star, or any host of heaven, this is what I have not commanded you. So the Lord, he hates star worship. In fact, he calls it an abomination in this chapter. And it carries the death penalty in scripture. It's quite heavy, isn't it? It's like, oof, well, don't want to be doing that. Don't want to be doing that. Yet, many would conclude that the worship of stars is no longer prevalent to anyone, really. Oh, you know, they're just rocks out there. They're just like gas giants. Like, we don't worship them. I mean, that's just ridiculous. That's just ridiculous. But the worship of stars is still very much alive today. And it's, in fact, one of the most subtle hidden agendas that's pushed on the populace by the satanic elite, and I'm going to show why in a minute. The motive of the satanic cabal for the past century has been to reignite this cosmic agenda, this cosmology, and they've tricked humanity by false pretenses into atheism and scientism, because as an atheist, you actually believe that you come from the stars, that the stars made you. So science tells you that two stars collided, and then the sun started spinning around gas and rocks and whisked up an omelette, and then all of a sudden Earth and humans are here. Oh, and in fact, you're all made of stardust, because from these supernovas, the stardust that is in you, that makes up the elemental properties of your body, well, that's from a star. So we all come from stars, and we come from the Big Bang. The Big Bang theory, you know, this big bong bang, and then everything's here, you know. So atheism actually teaches, they actually have a belief. So when you speak to an atheist and they say, I'm an atheist, me, I don't believe in anything. I said, well, you believe a lot, don't you? Where do you believe you come from? Well, a big bang. And how did Earth manage to be formed? Well, rocks and gases and forces. Oh, forces, where did they come from? What is this force? What is this force? Tell me more about it. And he suggests that gravity whipped all these rocks into a frenzy, and then they formed like these spherical things out there, and then all of a sudden, where are you? So they actually teach, their doctrine is actually that we come from the stars, that stars actually made us, that they are our creator, that they are our maker, that they are responsible for life on Earth, that the sun gives its life, that it's a dying star, and that we all get its light and blossom and bloom with photosynthesis, and the sun is slowly dying. The sun's giving its life, not the true sun, Son of Jehovah, the messianic Torah-keeping Jew who died as the atonement lamb sacrifice. This in science is that the sun is dying in the sky, and the sun is slowly dying, and one day it will implode on itself and all this and that. And they actually teach that we all come from the stars. That's what atheism teaches, that it's because of the stars. But they've moved Jehovah, the creator of heaven and earth, out the equation. And then we've been left with digital pictures. People believe this. None of them pictures are real on the screen. None of them. You type in and you'll never find a real picture of it. This is all just like digital imagery that's been like drew up by an artist. And people believe that they come from the stars. They come from the stars. The theory goes that it's because of the sun spinning around, using forces of gravity and collisions, and then all of a sudden humans were here. And it's absolute garbage. But these people put their faith in that very doctrine, that it's because of the sun, that it's because of these unseen forces, that it's because of gravity that we've all come to be. And it had nothing to do with Jehovah. And it's basically the stars that have forged this reality. The stars have made it so. But there's not a new under the sun, because this is what the ancient people of antiquity and different cultures of the worship of the gods. Because what we're going to unpack today is that all the gods from Babylon, Greece, Rome, Mesopotamia, they were actually all the planets. And we're going to see what the Bible actually says about the planets. We're going to unpack that today. So I'm going to get a bit of space age on the matter. But now, in the 21st century, beloved, we have been left with a godless, hopeless society that put all their faith in a book they've never read, in a theory they've never proven, in a star in a galaxy they've never seen, in a man that's speaking about theories they've never tested. And it's a belief system. Atheists believe in something. I say, I don't have enough faith to believe in that garbage, mate. That sounds mad, that. I mean, it doesn't even make sense to me. I don't have enough faith to believe in that, mate. I don't have enough faith to believe in that. And this is the doctrine, it's the cult of cosmology. It's here, it's alive and kicking. Listen, these are some news articles that I've plucked up. Humans really made from stardust, this new study proves. How 40,000 tons of cosmic dust falling to Earth affects you and me. We are made from stardust of old supernovas. Earth, how? Most of the elements in our body are actually found in stars, thus we are from star constellations billions of light years away. Scientists, unfortunately, are the modern day Gnostics. Like, the Bible, science and physics and things like that, they're like what the Lord has implemented. So this reality functions correctly. And everyone's like looking at the blueprint going, oh wow, that's like actually our God. And they're moving out the way, the fact that there's an architect. It's like having a rule book of how to make a go-kart and all the pieces of the go-kart, and then all of a sudden it magically appeared and you're like, oh wow, look, well, what about the man who put it together? It doesn't just appear. You've got the instructions and the manual of how to build it, and you've got all the components, but it takes intelligence to put it together. And they move God out the way, and all of these beautiful things and amazing things that I've got the signature and the fingerprint of God all over them, because we can't even make a grape seed from scratch. And look out there. Look at what God's done. The Bible says the heavens declare the Lord's handiwork. Night after night pours forth knowledge. Day after day pours forth speech. It's a testimony to what Jehovah has done. And they're just like focusing on the car parts, going, oh wow, that's God. It's like, no. It'd be like a builder who builds the house, you know. He has like a saw and a hammer and a box of nails, and he has all his materials. And he's got the blueprint, the architectural blueprint of how the house should be built. Okay? He needs his materials and his tools, and he needs the blueprint. And it's like, hundreds of years later, people have found this house, and they're like, there's a screw. The screw is our God. Look, the screw just happened, and the bricks happened. Aren't the bricks incredible? We come from brick dust. That's what it's like. It's madness. No, the builder built it, and like, just because he's just like not visible, it should just prove you, like, he's built this house. Stop looking at the brick dust, mate. Come in. You're not brick dust, bro.
Yeah, it's worshipping the creation and not the creator.
That's right. That's right.
But somehow, it's nothing's ever questioned, and when the slightest bit of like scrutiny, it all falls apart. And this is what gets me really, the madness of it all. How such nonsense can prevail for so long and be so prevalent. If people see, unfortunately, people are very gullible. The human race, I could say they're worse than gullible, but humans are very gullible. And they're like sheeple. A lot of people are like sheeple, where they're just, in fact, really, they're like leaves blowing in the wind, and wherever they land, you know. Without God, nothing makes sense. Mm-hmm. And when they're taught all this garbage and told it, it starts off as a theory and then it becomes fact, by the way. Right? They sold all this garbage. No one even questions it. You know, there's a saying in Spanish, only dead fish flow with the tide. And unfortunately, a lot of people are dead fish. They're just flowing with the tide. I'm not even thinking, well, what river am I in here? Or can I just swim off here for myself? People don't question anything. And that's how this garbage has been got away with for so long, that people will not question. And in a godless society, why even bother questioning?
Yeah, that's right. But the scientists, Tom, what are they like?
They're the latter day Gnostics. You know, I've always said that, you know, mm-hmm. I have. Because Gnosticism, science, the word science means know-how or knowledge or information. And the Gnostics, that were like people like Martian, and these people were up against Yeshua and the movements, etc., of God's people. These Gnostics would say, well, you just need mystical esoteric knowledge. You know, that's our salvation. You know? And like the Illuminati, these people are it's the same people. The Gnostics, the scientists, the Illuminati, these are the same people. They want to take God out of the picture and say, no, look, this is how it all happens, and this is the truth. It's twisted, it's deformed, it's distorted, it's deception, and it's nothing new. It's always been that way. Whether it's the saying of the planets or the stars or the stardust. We come from monkeys, apparently, and it was a big bang that just happened, fortunately, and all this random nonsense. But it's never questioned. But these scientists nowadays, they're the same as the Illuminati, the same as the Gnostics, the same as the... These people are godless people, disguise themselves as like, we have all the answers. You know, we're the truth.
False prophets.
It's false prophecy.
It's interesting, isn't it? Everything that science bases on is based on theory. It's all theory.
But then it's sorted as fact.
Yeah.
You see, these things like the theory of evolution, now sorted in schools.
Yeah.
And forget saying the prayers in assembly in schools, that's out now.
Yeah.
So gradually, over time, this theory, which is a load of garbage and lies and nonsense, and anti-God, it's just anti-God, yeah. It's all anti-God, and over time it becomes normal and accepted. And that's where we are. Because people don't question it. People will not question it.
It's a continuation of the lie in the garden, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. To the inquisitive mind, the Big Bang theory, it can be blown easily out of the water. Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm saying, the simplest of questioning.
The people that I've talked to, the evolutionists that I've talked to, there's two questions I asked them. One, in the beginning, according to them, there was nothing. It absolutely zip.
Nothing
at all. My question is, what exploded?
Yeah.
That's right.
If there was nothing, what exploded?
Yeah.
The second thing is that I don't know if anyone's heard of the preservation of angular momentum. That states that if a body, if an object is flung off a revolving object at certain speed, that object that's flung off will be spinning in the same direction as the host, right? So why in this solar system are there two planets that are spinning the opposite way? Those are the sort of things, and they've not been able to answer those questions yet. I've not heard a good answer to them, so, you know. So it's absolutely blown out of the water, straight away.
Well, this has been pressed upon us, and how have so many fell for it? How have so many fell for this cult of cosmology and this subconscious star worship that's been pressed into us? It all starts at an early age, beloved. We've all been victims to this. And each generation that comes on the scene is just gaining more momentum as the cult of cosmology just compounds it and compounds it and compounds it. And this is how it starts at an early age, right? Starts with kids. Like, the amount of pajamas that come our way with Saturn and Jupiter on, for the little baby, and dinosaurs as well. Lunch boxes covered in dinosaurs, pajamas covered in planets and stars, and that's how it starts, that. That's how it starts, that. And when you go into a classroom, it's the big globe, and then it's Space Jam, and it's Toy Story, and, you know, your cereal, your loops, and your orbits, and your lucky stars. When I was a kid, I used to come home with, like, sellotape right across my chest, and I'd be like, Mum, I've got a star, look. And you just all day you'd want to be the star of the class, and you'd just, you'd have a roll of sellotape across your chest. You'd be like stuck with the sellotape, with this little tiny merited star, and you want to be the star of the class, don't you? You know, and this is what they're getting you with. Proper Buzz Lightyear gear, mate. Everyone wants to be Buzz Lightyear. You know, the spaceman, I always wanted to be one. All this garbage is just thrown at us. It's just thrown at us, man. And I remember as a kid, one of my favourite places that I used to love to go, and if some of you might have been here, is the Liverpool Library. And it was the top floor on the Liverpool Library. Has anyone ever been? Was it?
Floor as well.
Yeah. I used to take me Star Wars TIE fighters, and I'd be like making all the noises, and I'd have like Luke Skywalker in my backpack, and I used to go to the top floor.
The planetarium.
The planetarium. Yeah, in my room. I used to have planets dangling from my room, flipping out. Well, I used to go to the top floor museum, the planetarium at the Liverpool Museum, and I'd be just in wonder. I'd be like, oh, there's a rocket, oh, there's a star. It wasn't until I got older and I went back that I realised it was all petrified wood, it was all plastic and prosthetics, and the whole thing was a theatrical set. It was just a set full of props, and nothing in there was legit, nothing. And then as I've got older, I've realised it's actually in a Greek temple, in a monolithic Greek temple, shaped like a Greek temple. It's got a library. What the, a library, come head. It's got a library in it. And it's a Greek temple with steps that goes up. And it's got all of this symbolism in there, and all of these gods and totem poles. And it's just a black. It's just a total black. It's all plastic and all prosthetic and digital artwork. But you can go on a school trip there. Oh, Mum, please sign. I want to go to the Liverpool Museum. I want to go to the planetarium. And it's free. Come and see it. It's free. It's free. We've got a free exhibition on about the stars. Come and have a look. And this is where it starts. This is how it starts when you're young. And then the older you get, it's the Armageddon, the Interstellar, the Star Trek, the Star Wars, 2001 Space Odyssey. Yeah. It just keeps going. And then Ziggy Stardust is played on repeat. David Bowie, Ziggy Stardust, and the Spiders of Mars, and all of a sudden you're just duped into this ludicrous that, yeah, you know, we all come from the stars, man. We're all cosmic travellers made of space dust in an insignificant drop in an ocean of infiniteness. It's infinite, darling, out there, because it's just space, man. And nothing I do now even matters, because this is just a Big Bang Theory. You know, no choice that I make matters. I'm so insignificant. It's survival of the fittest. I can do whatever I want. There's no consequences to whatever I choose to do. I'm not going to go anywhere when I die. It's just lights off. But that doctrine of when I die and I'm an atheist and nothing happens, it's lights off. That's like actually true. That's why God says that the worship of stars brings the death penalty. He's not like, you're gonna die because I'm like really angry and I'm jealous. He's telling you the natural cause and effect, that if you believe that you come from that rock or that star or that light, that is going to lead to death, because that's not me, and you're not going to get salvation from a light in the sky. It's just, it's not going to happen. And this is how it happens. And then all around society, everything we see, from the tabloids and the newspapers, the sun, the star, this and that, you know, even the chocolate that you buy in the shop, the galaxy, the Mars planets, the star bar. Yeah, this is what it is, bro. This is what it is. And all the stars of the earth, you know, the famous people go to the Golden Globes. Yeah. You know, it's the World Cup and Elon Musk and NASA. And this is what it is.
The Baphomet Award.
This is what we've ended up with. This is what we'd ended up with, you know. Now, I'm not saying that you're a devil worshipper if you've eaten a pack of Mars planets. I'm not saying that you're a devil worshipper, you know, if you've watched Interstellar or one of these Star Wars flicks. I'm not saying that. What I'm showing you is that this is like, this is an agenda, this is a mass agenda, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, all the leading people of fame are like now like talking about reaching the stars, star travel. You know, this is what's getting pushed. Everyone wants to be an astronaut, know what I mean? So I'm highlighting the mass agenda that's pushed upon us every single day, subconsciously, so subtle, you know, because 150, 200 years ago, this was just not even spoken of. None of this was even spoken of. You know what I mean? Go back even further. Go back even further. And this just would have just sounded like madness. But now this is what it is. It's a culture of star symbology. It's star symbology everywhere. And I mean, you can't even open up the tabloid. You know, a daily tabloid. You go and get your sun or your star. Some get the Daily Express. You read The Guardian, don't you, Tom?
I don't need any.
You open your tabloid, and there it is on your tabloid page. You get your horoscope. And what is a horoscope? Well, that's like a daily prophetic utterance of the star constellation that's in retrograde. That's gonna speak now to you a prophetic future of what your day is gonna entitle. And this is where we're at now. You know, newspapers in the shop, actually like tabloids, showing you this stuff. And it's just so normal. You meet people now, I meet people now, and I start clicking on and think, yeah, these are a little bit like onto stuff here. And so I start taking the conversation a little bit deeper. And then I always get hit with, oh, you're a Capricorn, you aren't you? And I'm like, I'm actually not a Capricorn, but you know, it's always the way, isn't it? Well, what star sign are you then? And people want to make these flash, rash judgments on, you know, what star constellation you are to see if you're going to be paired up with their mate because they're a Taurus. And like, the stars are governing people's lives here, mate. This is it. Like, this is it. There's not a new under the sun. But look, I'm not saying that there's not truth in these, because there is truth in it. And we're going to even see that the Bible says that the stars have an influence on us. I'm going to show you the scripture. And these things do have an influence on us. It can't even be seen. We can see it. But what I want to show as well is how these, you know, personality tests that are like coming through into society today, they are fundamentally forged on the star worship as well. Because certain constellations, when you were born in certain areas, that constellational power has an influence over you. And these personality tests, people got to be careful of. I know you've spoke about this in the past, Adam, haven't you?
Yeah, I mean, how long have you got, basically?
Well, just go for it, lah, whatever you think.
So these personality tests, so you've got two main schools of thoughts. You've got the Briggs-Meyer, which is a derivative of Jungian psychology.
Carl Jung, yeah.
Carl Jung was a renowned philosopher, psychologist, and deep into the occult. So the Myers-Briggs model, which is used predominantly like in like modern culture, I know employers use it. It's where you've got your ENFJs and all those like nine archetypes essentially.
I've had a manager actually make me take it before in an interview.
Yeah.
Wow.
Research it, it's really fascinating, but yeah, it's occult roots. Then you've also got the what's known as the Enneagram, which is similar to your little star chart there, which is, again, it's different. It's based on Mesopotamian numerology, but over the years, different people have appropriated it, changed it, given it a glossy look, and then it's now preached in churches. I know pastors who do preaching series on personality tests, and it's all deep rooted in the occult. Is the abridged? Have a Google, and you'll see. It's just like
I felt for it so long ago.
Yeah, and I've had full blown out arguments with other Christians about using personality tests proper, like, and their heads have blown off, and I'm like, no, it's a cult, like. It's mediumship, it's divination, it's soothsaying, like it's there, it's all there in Deuteronomy. It's not like, oh, don't do that, like it's a transgression, it's an abomination. Mm-hmm. An abomination, like, so, but it's not only, okay, and it also says in the scriptures that the nations will do these things. Mm-hmm. That's what the nations do. Yeah. We don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
So why is the evangelical church started doing it? Why is it now being taught as like a, yeah, so, yeah, it's just beware, basically. If somebody starts going, oh, you're a number nine, you are. No, you're full of number two. Like, but no, just a heads up. Joe's saying, oh, it's in society, it's in culture. I expect that from that, but I don't expect it from the church, but it is well and truly in there. It's at best misleading. It's at worst, it's a false gospel. It's going right back to the garden, like Martin said, you shall be as gods. It's taking that principle of sanctification, God's handiwork, and I've always said it's like you're going beyond the veil, essentially, and we're not supposed to. It's like you take your car to the mechanic, let the mechanic do the work. There's all the components, there's all the bits and pieces, but I'm not the mechanic. I'll give it to you and you can do the work. That's how
the moment you say, have a go, your car and you say, might break.
Yeah. But yeah.
Thanks, bro. This is what we've heard it said, haven't we? It's written in the stars. It's written in the stars. The stars are aligning on this one. Stars are aligning. This is what the book of Isaiah says. Isaiah 47:13-14. You are worn out by your many plans. Let your astrologers and let your stargazers, who foretell the future month by month, come to you, rise up and save you. They are like straw. Fire burns them away. They are unable to rescue themselves from the flames. I mean, it's not going to announce a nothing when the stars start falling down to earth in the book of Revelations. These things are falling to earth. What are the horoscopes gonna do? That's gonna be a horoscope, spelled H-O-R-R-O-R-S. Horoscope, man. Because it's gonna get legit. It's gonna get super serious. But look, this is pushed on us everywhere. I mean, even the flags and the banners of this earth have stars on them. All of them have got stars on them. Now, it's curious because there's certain fallen angels in legion, in military precision, that operate over certain nations, and they've been given authority. You know, Satan takes Yeshua and shows him all the kingdoms of the world, all the kingdoms of the world, and says, all of these shall be yours because they have been given unto me. And what we're going to realize now is actually these stars in the sky are actually angels. They're actually angelic. They're actually of an angelic property. They're angelic entities. And there's the vast majority of them that are law-abiding. They do what God says. That sun does what God says. That's got impeccable timing. It's law-abiding. The moon abides by God's law. And the celestial luminaries move around Earth. And they actually move in a circle. But then there is some known as the planetas, or the planets. They're in rebellion. They're moving around. That people don't even know what they are. What are they? You know, they're saying that there's some like mad planet out there that you can go and you can actually like land on it. We're going to break that down. But what I want to show is these countries venerate the star. They venerate it. It's there. It's there. What is it? What is it? We're going to see how God doesn't want this. All right. What does it say in the book of Acts? You've taken up the star of your God, Remphan. You've lifted up a tabernacle of Molech. Now, these stars are subconsciously over these countries that they're bannered. the bannered up, this is what that nation is representing. And nations venerate the star and banner representing their country, and it's no coincidence. I'm going to get more into that in a minute, but I want to show you this. This is the latest, the flash news, by the way. These are the latest images from NASA. All right, you're getting the latest images now. I mean, Jupiter looks like a bath bomb to me. That just looks like a bath bomb. Or one of them gobstoppers. Yeah, the iPhone, or one of them gobstoppers, but it's a calf kids and bath bomb now. So on screen, they're the latest NASA images. That is Jupiter. That's Jupiter, that. Believe me. And it's just forever in our faces, isn't it? It's the Hubble telescope, this. The rover of Mars, that. NASA, this. Elon Musk, that. SpaceX, this. SpaceX, that. Space, 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 space. And it's just, they never mention God. They never mention God. They never mention a creator. It's always this light or this rock or this nebula. And it's like, oh, yeah, wow, yeah, actually, yeah, we are from that nebula, yeah. Now, as I mentioned before, I'm not suggesting that there is no truth in certain aspects of astronomy and in the influence of stars, which is known as astrology. You know, Satan, he can't make nothing up, but these things are true. You know, they do have a certain truth about them, but as Darren mentioned, we're not meant to go after these things, and we're not meant to try and unpack it and know the science behind it to use it, because a lot of it is actually used for your own gain. Oh, look, today I'm going to meet someone new, and you know, because Mars is in retrograde, oh, actually, like, I'm going to bump into the love of my life. And now you're on the scene looking around for the love of your life because the Daily Star's just told you so. Yeah. You know, like the newspaper tabloids just told you. But then it gets even sinister. I know people that have read their constellation and they say, this is actually how I'm going to die, bro. And I'm like, oh, wow, that's really heavy. And I did used to believe certain aspects of it, especially in the Egyptian side of the star observation. But what I want to show you now is how the stars do actually have an influence on us. They do. They just do. So the moon can navigate certain animals to migrate in certain moon cycles. There's certain animals that will mate and reproduce in certain moon cycles. You know, women with their own cycle, even men with their own cycle. When the sun gets closer, everything blooms. When it moves further away, everything dies. So these constellations and these stars in the sky, they do actually have
tides of the ocean.
Yeah, the tides of the ocean. They do actually have a tangible, like, real impact on us. Okay, they just do. But it's God who's making all this happen. You get me? And we never have to venerate that certain element or that certain body for whatever reason. But yet, the Bible does say that these stars do have an influence on us. And that's why people actually invest in astrology and go, it's true, it is right. And, you know, I've got a faith in it because, like, it's shown me loads of stuff about myself. And, like, no one could make that up. It's like you've gone to visit a psychic or a medium. And the stars, they will, because they do have an influence on society. And there's certain stars in the sky that are actually in rebellion, what we're going to learn about. Job says this, and it's only found in the King James Version, this. Job 38:31. Canest thou bind the sweet influences of Pleiades? Are we all familiar what Pleiades is? It's a star constellation in the sky. Orion is another one. The belt of Orion, as we know it as. But the Bible says that God, when he's challenging Job, when he's challenging Job, he's saying to Job, listen, mate, you've got stuff going on here now and you're challenging me over this. But can you bind the influences of Pleiades? Can you halt the influences of the stars? Can you loosen the stars in the sky? You haven't got a clue what I'm doing with these things. And Job's just flabbergasted and dumbfounded, isn't he? Because God's actually saying, I'm the one who even controls the stars in the sky. You haven't even got a clue what you're talking about. You've got a voice and you're speaking to me, and I'm the one who scattered the stars and spread it out like a tent to dwell in. You know, I'm the one who knows every grain of sand on the sea, every drop and every molecule in the ocean and every atom in your body. You know, this is Jehovah speaking now. But he's the one who combined the influences of the stars. Right, and he's the one who can loosen. Binding and loosening is always referred to, like, incarceration and freedom. So there's certain ones that are incarcerated and there's certain ones that are in freedom, which we're going to understand soon, because these stars do have an influence on us. They just do. These stars also have an identity. Psalm 147:4-5. He counts the number of stars. He calleth them all by their names. All right, you don't call a rock a name, do you? You don't call when you're spraying an aerosol or you're putting your deodorant on, or you don't say that's got an identity, that's got a character, that's got a name. No, these things in the sky, these luminaries, they're actually called by name. They're not like rocks spinning round from the sun. That's just garbage. They're actually heavenly bodies, which is what we're going to learn. This is what Paul says, 1 Corinthians 15. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh for a man, another kind of flesh for an animal, another kind of flesh for a fish, another kind for a bird. There are also celestial bodies, or heavenly bodies, as it's translated in some other translations. And there is terrestrial bodies, which is earthly bodies. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of a terrestrial is another. There are also one glory for the sun, one glory for the moon, and another glory for the stars. Yet one star differs from another star in glory. And that word glory in the Greek is doxa, and it can mean character. It can mean majesty. It can mean property. It can mean elementary. So Paul's saying that these stars also have a character. One differs from another character. So they've got a name, they've got a character, they can be bound and loosened, they've got freedom, and they've also got a character. That's interesting. They've also got a flesh, not a flesh like what our flesh. They've got a material substance that is able for them to be seen in this five-sense reality. They're able to be witnessed and experienced. So they have like a material substance. The Bible also says that not all the stars are pure. Don't be deceived. Listen to this, Job 15:15. Behold, God put no trust in his holy ones. Yea, even the heavens are not clean in his sight. Now, I don't believe that's his throne. I believe that is the second heaven, what we would call, you know, the visible space. That's what I believe that's getting said here. Job 25:5. Yea, not even the stars are pure in his sight. Not even the stars are pure in his sight. Isn't that interesting? You wouldn't say that about a rock, would you? These have got something else going on. There's something deeper going on here, beloved. Job 38:6-7. Stars actually sing. The stars are singing. Listen. On what were its found? This is God rebuking Job again, and he's mentioning the stars. On what were its foundation set, or who laid the cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. So we see that correlating symbolism now, because the sons of God are actually the angels. We see this morning star and the sons of God actually being correlated together as angels. In the book of Revelations, Yeshua has seven stars, which are the seven angels, okay, over the seven churches. So stars and angels are actually synonymous. But when we look at like archangels and seraphim, they're like different classes of angels. An angel is just like a melech. It means a messenger. It means it's a broad term for many different subsequent sets of angelic hosts or entities. But the stars are actually, in fact, as the Bible says, angels, the messengers, the influencers. They have influences on us. They're for signs and seasons, the Bible says. So yet they do actually have an impact on us. They are a moed. They are an indicator. They are an influencer. They are a warning. They are alert. Yeshua says, when ye see all these things in the signs in the heavens, then you know that the Son of Man's on his way back. So they are influencers, alerts, you know, signals, so to speak. Job 1:6 says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also with them. Now, we've just seen in that previous verse that the sons of God shouted for joy, that the symbolic with the morning stars that sang together. Now, what I want to show here is that these stars, as it says, that they're singing, that they sang at creation, they're actually still making a sound now today. And this actually can be seen, this using oscillations and technologies, you're actually able to point acoustic receptors at these stars that they say they're moving through space, but they're actually resonating and they're actually making sounds. And you can go and you can check this out online. They put these sounds online at these certain stars, and they're all making noise, they're all making sounds, they're all making song, and people put them together in the certain keys, and these things are actually like singing. They're like actually singing. It's mad. You know, you can listen to a couple of them online, and here's some articles. NASA releases the sound of 5,000 outer space oddities. We can't hear it with our ears, but the stars in the sky are performing a concert that never stops. The biggest stars make the lowest and deepest sounds, like double basses, and small stars are like high-pitched voices. And when you listen to it, they do sound like voices. It's mad. It's mad. And as again, you know, the Bible is the truth, and science just confirms the Bible even further, doesn't it? So they're not the only stars that are singing, though. And this is why our world is obsessed with the stars that sing in unholy wood. These are the modern day stars. Now, why are they called the stars? The stars with supreme talent. And everyone is at a concert and they worship them. And they come out and they're in floods of tears. And they're so moved by emotion. They're so moved by emotion as these stars walk out on stage. Just a picture. Just a glimpse, just a touch of that star. Just a touch of that star. This is what people are actually falling for. And they all go to the Golden Globes. And they walk on a red carpet, which is Masonic, for trampling underfoot the blood of the covenant. Because they think they're elevated over the blood. This is who these people are. And they're all doing the devil horns. And I'm not saying they're all in on it and they're all Satanists. The majority of them are deceived and they just live the lavish life, and they get used. They've sort of sold out and they get used. They're just getting used. But this this Hall of Fame, as it's known in Hollywood, I want to show you something here. There's all these pentagrams on the floor in Sunset Boulevard, and this stretch goes on for nearly 2 miles. But what happens is all these so-called famous people who are engrossed in stardom, they actually bend down and have this ritual take place where in the Sunset Boulevard in the city of Los Angeles. In the city of Los Angeles, this is Lost Angels, the Lost Stars, you know. They all bend down in this Kabbalistic ritual. And if you look on the screen there, this is the Babylonian court in Los Angeles. And it's got Nimrod, Marduk, Anzu, all these Babylonian deities. And it's flagellated like a ziggurat stargate. And it's directly, the 2 mile stretch leads to the Babylonian courtyard. So all these people are actually bowing down on the knees to Nimrod. And they're all getting their handprint and they're all laughing. And they're all the stars, they're the famous stars. But they're all taking part in a massive Babylonian ritual. And they're all bowing down to Nimrod. Because the Babylonian gate is opposite to the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And the Babylonian ziggurat was actually to conjure the angels. It was a stargate to reach and penetrate the heavens. And all these people don't even know. But really, everyone is just bowing down facing Nimrod and Anzu. And they're all bowing down. They're the true stars. And they all want to be a star. And the only way you get venerated and get one of them on the floor is by doing what the masters say. Good boy, sit. That's what it's like. This is what it's like. But people love these people, you know, and these are the modern day, you know, the modern day idols of the world, you know, and they call themselves stars. Come on, it's right in front of you. It's right there. This is not a conspiracy. It's just not a conspiracy. It's right there. Jude 1, verse 6. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness till the day of judgment of the great day. I want to get back to the true stars, not these, you know, not these. I want to get back to the true stars because all these are flawed, and every week there's a new one coming out who's a pedo or a rapist or going to court for this or that, and they're all just totally defiled, you know, and people rock up to the concert and worship them as these, like, drug-fueled, like, fallen people walk on stage and just spout all their talents, never glorifying God. All the talents were given to glorify God, never doing that. Well, Jude tells us that the angels left their first habitation. All right, so they've left their habitations and an estate where they once dwelt. So I see the first estate was where they were originally in the angelic realm. And then the habitation is something to do with their habitat in a celestial, terrestrial sense. Okay, now they've left that, and we know why did the angels choose to rebel and come to earth? What was it?
To go after the daughters.
To go after the women. So, just as the angels lusted, so it was lust in the beginning, weren't it? Eve's eyes, she was beguiled, and the lust of the eyes made her sin and fall. Lust was the same thing that made the angels fall as well. It's so big. And they abandoned their heavenly estate to come down here and go after women, because there's only one way this being of light, this luminary, is able to go into a woman, and that's to make himself like this, isn't it? And this is what I believe all these gods of antiquity were, you know, the Zeus, the Hercules, the Hermes, you know, these demigods with supernatural powers from Greece to Egypt, that was all the gods, and they come to Earth and they got these supernatural abilities. But what we found out now in studying these ancient cultures of antiquity is that all these gods like Zeus, Apollo, Poseidon, they were actually the planets. So the Greeks were actually saying, oh yeah, that's Zeus, and Zeus is moved over there in Olympus. And Apollo was the sun, Zeus was Jupiter, Mercury was Hermes, Neptune was Poseidon. And it's these planets that we can observe that are moving around, that aren't moving in order with the other stars. They're moving all over the gaff. They're the ones like all over the gaff in the solar system. And even the ancient Babylonians named their gods after the planets. Marduk was Jupiter. Mercury was Nebo. Venus was Ishtaris, the fertility goddess. And now in our modern day age, all the kids are going mad for this. This is the demigod archetype. And notice as well how they're always dressed in Greek attire. They've always got weapons. They're always waging war. Captain America with the pentagram on him there. And this is it. It's the guardians of the galaxy. It's the gods again in it. Supernatural power, you know, saving humanity, involved and influence humanity from behind the scenes. And what do they always do? They're always off-worldly aliens. And they're always getting it on with human women. They're always getting it on with human women. Always. They're always falling in love with the human woman. You get me? Or, you know, the celestial being, the woman, is always falling in love with the human man. And this is what it is. This is what it is. This isn't new, though. This is written about in the Bible. Judges 5:20. Believe it or not, the stars fought in heaven. Yes, the stars in their orbits fought against Sisera. So we actually see that the stars are waging war. There's a war in the heavens. We know that in Revelations. We know in Daniel, Michael is waging war in the heavenly cosmos with Satan. So we see these things going on. And the book of Judges tell us that the stars fight in heaven. This is why, you know, whether it's like the Norse mythology with Thor and his hammer, or it's like the Greek mythology with Zeus and his lightning, that they're all battling in the Olympia in the second heaven. But there is a war going on there, beloved. There is a war going on. And we're going to see how Paul says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood on earth. We wrestle with principalities in the cosmos, he says. Cosmic powers of authority up there in the second heaven. They're all doing mad things, you know what I mean? It's not some rock spinning round. It's not. These are like entities up there. Entities, and this is the modern day understanding of it, pushed on the masses again, pushed on the masses again. Now we're going to wrap up after this. I want to show in the book of Acts how this idea of the gods coming to earth and being the planetary systems, it was alive then, and it's alive now, and it's still a doctrine. Because in the book of Acts, bit of background to this scripture, Paul and Barnabas are on ministry and they're smashing it, and they bring healing, and next minute these people in this like Greek area, they start proclaiming that, oh, Paul, he's Mercury, and Barnabas, oh, well, he's Jupiter. And they actually call him by the planetarian names, and they call him by the Greek gods. Listen to this, Book of Acts 17. In Listeria, there was a certain man without strength in his feet who was sitting, a cripple from his mother's womb who had never walked. This man heard Paul speaking. Paul, observing him intently and seeing that he had the faith to be healed, said to him with a loud voice, stand up straight on your feet. And he leaped and he walked. Now when the people saw what Paul had done, they raised their voices, saying in the Laodicean language, the gods have come down in the likeness of men. And Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Mercury, because he was the chief speaker. This was the understanding that the planetas, the wandering stars up there, come to earth. And the Bible tells us that that was the fallen angels. We've just read how the stars are angels. So this is not new. But what happens? But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes. they knew this was a transgression of Deuteronomy 17. And they said to the multitude crying out, men, why are you doing these things? We are also men of the same nature. All right, we're not the planetas, we're not the demigods, we're as you and me, we're of the same nature. We are preaching to you that you should turn from these useless things and serve the living Elohim. Elohim in Hebrew, the Hebrew God. The Hebrew God, okay? Not Poseidon, Poseidon, or Apollo, or this or that. The living God. The living God, Elohim, the Hebrew deity of Israel. That's who they were saying serve. They would have said Eloha. Elohim, Jehovah, Yahweh. That's what they were proclaiming. That's what they were proclaiming. Amen. So just finally now, Jude 1:13, we're told in Jude that there is wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. So in Jude's rebuke, he's saying that there's apostates out there, you know, the clouds without water, the this, the that, the this. And then he says this in verse 13, they are wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Now, I don't know about you, but the blackness being reserved in blackness and darkness forever sounds like some pretty horrific condemnation. Why would you want to do that to a rock that's just float? Why would you want to do that to poor Pluto? Why would you want to do that to Pluto? You know, why would you want to do that? What is this wandering star that's out there, that's wandering around, that's reserved for the blackness of darkness forever? What is this all about? What is all this about? And Tom, tell them what the word wandering star means in the Greek. It's planetas.
Yeah, planetas. It's when our Lord made the sun and the moon and the stars. Like you said earlier, they all had the instructions and they followed the instructions. And then when Satan rebelled and he had his followers, some of these rebelled also. And then some were instantly just locked up and chained up, put away, you know, and they're still there now. They'll all forever will be there. And then there were some that were allowed to just go on their course, because God will bring good from bad. Obviously, he said, well, you go along on your course and then one day you're going to be in eternal darkness. Yeah. That's what I have in store for you. And this is what people call the planets.
Yes.
It's in from the Greek planetas, but basically they are the ones that rebelled with Satan.
That's right, yeah.
That's what they are.
So Jude 1:13 could actually say the planets out there that we can view with the eye, not through the Hubble telescope, because no one could see them. These are the planets that can be viewed with the visible eye. The planets for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. So there's not so much of an innocence about certain things out there, beloved. There's not so much of an innocence. And these planetas are under serious, serious, serious penalty of condemnation to doing something that influences us in one way or another. And this is why in astrology or astronomy, it's get your crystals out because Mars is in the subtropic of Capricorn. And it's like, oh no, please don't do that. That's actually veneration of the stars. And that doesn't sound like poor Pluto to me. You know, that just doesn't sound like poor Pluto the dog. I mean the planetas. It just does not sound like Pluto to me. This is not some rock floating around in space, okay? These have serious influence on humanity and they're all part of the cosmological plan of Jehovah, which in part two, we will understand the rebellious planet. So just a quick recap, we were looking at the subtle subconscious star programming agenda that had been taking place, and it's all about looking at the stars, and you know, we see these big institutions and we see how it's drip fed, drip, drip, drip. And this doctrine that we all come from the stars is actually fundamental star worship. Now, I want to show how even the most prolific Satanist known as Aleister Crowley, who wrote books about drinking the blood of virgins, he even proclaimed in his book of the law that every man and every woman is a star. And that's the satanic doctrine. That's Satanism. And that's the same stuff that's coming out of National Geographic, SpaceX, National this, that, NASA. That's exactly what they're saying now, today. So you've got it there in black and white. Aleister Crowley, the prolific Satanist, is saying it with a star pentagram on his book and the Illuminati third eye pyramid on his forehead, on his pineal there. And he's the one coining this term, every man and woman is a star. And now you know exactly where it's been coming from. You get me? So when you hear like NASA and all this saying this and that, it's actually been coined from Aleister Crowley a lot longer than that before. I want to have a little look at the rebellious planets now. Let's unpack this mystery a bit, but to do it, you've got to get into the Book of Enoch. Now, a disclaimer, I don't take the Book of Enoch as a canon. I just don't. I think you've got to take it with a pinch of salt. I think it can give you a science behind certain things and an explanation and an understanding, but I'm not saying that's it. This is the definitive truth. So that's a disclaimer on this. But I am going to quote from it because I think it can give you an understanding and you take what you will from it. But this is what the Book of Enoch says about the stars. And the stars which roll over the fire are which have been transgressing the commandments of the Lord in the beginning of their rising, because they did not come forth at the appointed times. So, I mean, this is why Enoch now tells us that these stars transgress the commandments of the Lord, because they didn't come forth at the Moedim. Shows you how important the Moedim is, isn't it? Appointed time means Moedim.
And the role they play.
And the role that they play in the Moedim. And I think that these are the ones, the planetas, that are flying around up there that aren't really doing as they should be. Okay, that's where I'm at. That's where I'm leaning towards. And obviously we take Enoch with a pinch of salt, but Enoch sort of tells us why, you know, why they were like sort of condemned, that there's certain ones out there that didn't come forth at the appointed time. It's pretty serious, isn't it? But you've got to understand, if Jehovah has spoke life into existence, founded the heavens and the earth, and used these luminaries to indicate and play a role in reality, and then they all start like not doing what he said and not popping up at the right time. Oof, serious, you know, that's like galactic rebellion, yeah. Cosmological rebellion. It's massive. So it's deep. And we know that in Genesis, God gave the stars four appointed times. So why did these stars not come forth at the appointed times? And it shows you why it's so important to come forth at the appointed time. That's why we do the Moedim, and God's so serious about it. He's so serious about it. Now, as I spoke about before, upon observation, you can, you know, these have been photographs that have been took and then layered on top of one another. And like, you know, if you were to stand in one place, all the constellations would move round you like this cyclically, yeah? And they move like that. Every night they move like that. Cyclical, bang, Lord abiding, bang. Like a watch, like a clock. Lord abiding, Lord abiding, Lord abiding. When you look at these planets, they move in a different manner. It's like they're not coming forth in their appointed time. You get me? They're whizzing across the sky. They're over here, they're over there, they're over here, they're over there. These planetas, they move in a different order. That's what we would know as the planets. The seven out there in the sky that move in all different directions that you can see with your eye. Now, could this be that there are certain cosmic powers in rebellion still in the heavens and they're not coming forth in their appointed time even today? But through their rebellion, they're actually having a cataclysmic event on humanity and God's creation. Now, when you actually put these patterns of the stars together, the Lord abiding stars, the Lord abiding luminaries, they move and create a circle every time. They just move round and create a circle every time. Hallelujah, man, for the first words, Dada.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Abba.
But when we look at the planetas and then we put their courses together, look at this, get a load of this. And these are now numerical pattern geometries of the heavenly planetas. So if you were to study the pattern of Saturn and overlap its orbit and overlap its orbit and overlap its orbit, this is what you're going to get. On the screen now are the different planetas and how they actually move in the sky. And when you overlap and overlap their orbits over years, they start making these geographical patterns. Now, these same patterns are the same patterns what you conjure devils with. I know this because I've studied a lot of the occult, and how you conjure a demon is that you make these certain patterns on the floor with salt at certain moon cycles at certain intervals. And what you do is you conjure these demons that actually reside. They actually tell you that they come from Sirius or this or that place or this place or that place, that they actually dwell in the heavens. You pull them down to earth using the constellation, and it would make sense, because if that's their signal, that's almost like their key to unlocking them, you get me? And this is the shapes that they make in the sky, and then that's the shapes that you make on earth if you want to get in touch with them. And that, so this is what that witchcraft is all about. That's what I believe it is. And I believe we're going to see this now with Ephesians, with what Paul says. This is what Paul says, I quoted it before. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. All right, so get any human out of your head. If you're having any trouble with anyone on earth, get them out of your head, because you're not wrestling with them. Paul says so. You're wrestling against the principality, you're wrestling against the power, and you're wrestling against a ruler of darkness of this age, a spiritual host of wickedness in heavenly places. No flesh and blood involved in this war. You're wrestling against, in the ESV, a cosmic power. That's in the English Standard Version. Paul tells us we're wrestling against cosmic powers in the cosmos, the second heaven. And it would make sense that these things are spinning all over the earth in rebellion, putting all these satanic symbols all over the gaff. You know, and then these mad people want to conjure these things and get in touch with them. But really, they're the fallen ones in rebellion, and they are cosmic powers. Rulers of the darkness of this age. You know, a lot of people say, you know, I'm binding Satan up and I'm binding this and that, and I'm like, are you joking me? You're wrestling against cosmic powers here. These are rulers that have been given authority by Jehovah. Step back from this, mate. Step back from all this, like, because I'm serious, these are cosmic powers. I'm not trying to put fear into people. No, Archangel Michael would not even bring a railing accusation against Satan, but said, rather, Jehovah rebuke you. We don't want to get into all binding Satan and binding this and that, because, like, these are cosmic powers, you know, these are principalities. It's only the Lord who says, I am the one who can bind the influences of Pleiades, you get me? Now, this word for cosmic power, or spiritual host of wickedness in heavenly places, it translates cosmocrator in the Greek. Sounds very much like a cosmic creator, cosmocrator. And it translates rulers, authorities, and devils. And I was going to ask you, Tom, maybe you could...
Well, I don't also know about that. It's a Greek word, isn't it? The cosmo, like cosmos, that means world. And the krator bit means to rule. So cosmocrator is the one who rules the world, basically. Mm-hmm. So this is another title for the devil. Yeah, that's a title for the devil, or any one of his ilk, basically.
Yeah, and that's why we've got to be careful what, you know, what type of spiritual war we're engaging with. We've got to be wise as serpents, gentle as doves. We've got to know our enemy, and we've got to know the truth, and we've got to be walking in the spirit to be able to do this correctly. You get me? Because these are cosmic craters. They are like rulers of the cosmos, rulers of cosmic powers in dark, sinister places. Sinister places, that's where they reside. Yeah.
They work independently of God, basically.
That's right, yeah.
That's their motive.
But God's allowing it.
Yeah, of course. God's allowing it. Of course, yeah.
He's got them on the leash. So Satan and the stars now. I want to unpack this a little bit. Satan and the stars. Let's get to it. What's the punch of this? Satan is always related to the cosmos above, right throughout the scripture. Yeshua said, I saw Satan fall from heaven to earth like lightning. Remember, he's an angel of light. He was a being of light, we are told in Ezekiel. He's arrayed in topaz and sapphire. And Satan, he was known as a shining one who fell from heaven to earth below. Okay. And this is what the book of Isaiah says about Satan. This is what he calls him. He goes by the title of the morning star. Isaiah 14 verse 12. You have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to earth, you who once laid low the nations. And this is Satan, you see. And he fell from consecutive heavens. He fell. And the last place he's going to come as the Antichrist and is the embodiment of a terrestrial Antichrist on earth. And he's yet to do that, though. I personally think that Satan is up there in the second heaven, but he's also able to come into people's lives, and he even appears to Yeshua. But he's going to try and get his way through as a human, like, yes, in the same way God did in the Immaculate Conception. He's trying to do that himself, okay, because he, the son of perdition, the man of perdition, he's got to stand on the scene, he's got to stand in that temple, and this is what we know is going to kick off the coming of the end. This is what we're all waiting for. But he's called the morning star. And this prophesied rebellion of the heavenly luminaries, it is found in Scripture. And we find it all the way through, even to Revelations. And this is what he does. He's going after the stars. Listen, Revelation 12, verse 4, Satan the dragon whips his tail, and he drew a third of the stars of heaven, and he throws them to earth. Now, the nearest star is Alpha Centauri in our so-called constellations. The nearest star, we got like Andromeda, and we got this Alpha Centauri. That's bigger than our sun. Now, if that was to fall to earth, that would just obliterate this place, so-called, because it's bigger than our sun, so-called. If you're going on all these, it can't be that. When these stars fall to earth, they're not like Andromeda and Alpha Centauri that are like 50 times bigger than our sun. Loads of these stars are falling. These are actually angelic beings, you know, and they're not like 50 billion this and that and that. It's just getting, starts getting mad. That's not what they are. Yeah, but
the book of Revelation, it wouldn't make sense, would it? How could they fall down?
How could they fall to earth without just destroying the earth? They fall at consecutive intervals, and certain seals and trumpets still taking place. And you know, but what these things are, these are fallen angels, and they actually bring devastations and cataclysmic events that like are all triggered in the end times. Elsewhere, we read this, Revelations 8-10. Then the third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch, and it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of water. The name of that star is Wormwood. A third of the waters became wormwood, and many died from the water because it was made bitter. Now, this is not like some massive gas giant, like bigger than the sun, like coming to earth, and everyone's like, because it just obliterates everything. This is a fallen angel, and it's got a name of bitterness. And it's sent to earth, it's unleashed, it pops out of the heavens and falls down, and then it triggers cataclysmic events and devastations on earth. Now, curiously, the word Chernobyl, we all know about Chernobyl and the nuclear reactor. Well, that's the translation in the Ukrainian language for wormwood. Now, that's what happened at Chernobyl. It was a nuclear meltdown. All the water, all the surrounding area became devastated. People couldn't drink from it. Now, I don't believe in coincidence, me. I believe that, like, as it says in the Bible, the Lord does nothing without first revealing it to his prophets, that God shows us certain things, like events in time, whether it be, like, you know, Rome and the Nazis and this and that, and it's all leading to, like, this end time. Like, all of these figures, like Pharaoh, you know, Stalin, Nimrod, they're all, like, pictures of the Antichrist, do you get me? They're all, like, types and shadows. And I believe this Chernobyl, this like nuclear meltdown, was like a type and shadow of wormwood. So much so, they've even got an angel, that there's a statue of an angel blowing a trumpet in Chernobyl. Wow. I mean, you can't get much, and it's called wormwood. You know, people still can't go there today. Mm. Now, it translates as wormwood, and I think this is what we're going to see. This devastating star, this angelic host. And what do I believe angels are? I believe they're like electromagnetic. So that's what radiation is. It's electromagnetic. You can be getting contaminated with radiation and don't even know about it. It's like killing you from behind the veil. It's all these people that die in like certain scriptures with the Torah and the Tanakh. When angels smite them, they don't even know what's happened, and the next minute they're all dead. And it's like radiation. When Chernobyl went into meltdown, there was blue beams like Star Trek coming out of the reactor, and everyone thought that they were doing a light show. It's never ever been seen. And when you look at it, that's it, because you've seen this blue beam. What would Moses say? That they were conjuring some angel in that place and harnessing this power. That's what all the prophets would tell you. They've been conjuring an angel in there and harnessing its power. And when it broke out, all this blue, and everyone who's seen it just died, like, weeks, months later, and all the water was contaminated. Like, that was a snippet of what happened on Earth in a certain place at a certain time. What's going to happen when a third of the waters, nothing can be drunk? You know, the hysteria, the paranoia, what are people going to do to one another? We just turn on the tap, boom. You don't miss the water till the well run dry. Yeah. You know, when that well runs dry, that water is going to be like everything for everybody, because you go without it a couple of hours, a couple of days, that's it. You know what I mean? So these things are going to fall to earth, and I think we've been shown already, beloved, by God, saying, look, this is it, this is it, this is it, this is what it is.
Yeah, it's just like the way we have the type and shadows of like Joseph, which pictured Messiah. We have the type and shadows of the Antichrist. That's what you're saying.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
We're seeing these two type and shadows all.
Yeah, and we see 70 AD when you know Jerusalem was invaded, and Yeshua says, you know, run to the hills, don't go back to the city. If you're in a field, don't go back to get your clothes or your belongings. And Rome destroyed Israel, you know, and that 70 AD is like a type and shadow of the future, you know, armies surrounding Jerusalem. So it's all there, these things that happened in history. I just wanted to put that out there for food for thought and making that connection with Wormwood, the great star that fall, burns like a torch. And when it burns like a torch, a third of the rivers and the springs of water and contaminated, can't drink from them, makes them bitter, makes them radiated. And what does it say? Many died because of it. You know, radiation is an electromagnetic killer. It's stealth, kills you in stealth. No one even knows it's happening to them until it's too late. And that's it. And it's like the beyond the veil, so to speak. It's, you're getting killed from something that's invisible, an invisible enemy. Enoch 26 again. And there I saw seven stars of heaven bound together in it, like great mountains burning with fire. Then I said, for what sin are they bound? And on what accounts have they been cast here? Then Uriel, one of the holy angels who was with me and was chief over them, said, Enoch, why doest thou ask? And why art thou eager for the truth? These are the number of stars of heaven which have transgressed the commandments of the Lord. So we know that they've gone against the commandments of the Lord, right? So if the stars of heaven transgressed the commandments and it was held against them, and if they come to earth to lust after women and it was lust that was held against them, what is it for us then to keep the appointed times, keep the commandments and abstain from the lust of the eyes? It's the same thing. It's the same things that brought down the demise of the angels. We don't want it to bring down our demise. And that idea of this star is like a great mountain burning with fire, that's in Revelations. Look, Revelations 8:8. And the second angel sounded, and there it was, as it were, a great mountain burning with fire, and it was cast into the sea, and a third part of the sea became blood. Again, it's a fallen angel. Again, it's a star in heaven. What's going on here? This isn't some like actual mountain on fire, like Ben Nevis or like Snowdonia, just like
a volcano.
Well, there's
because I mean that pulls out fire and it can actually
it could be Sonia
take away the land, can't it, and go into the water.
Yeah, it could be Sonia, and this is obviously this is all up for debate because this book is yet to be fulfilled, isn't it? So it's like it's eschatology, so we sort of got to work that out. I'm showing the symmetry there of a star of heaven. Like a great mountain burning with fire, and saying, look, is this a little bit more? What's going on here? What's this mountain burning with fire that's cast into the sea? What is it? Is it like a volcano? Yeah, it could be that. But what I want to show is there's a principality. This is like an entity. There's something going on here that's causing all of these things. Finally, I want to show how the cosmic disturbances are for the doomed. Revelation 6, 12 to 17. I looked, and when he opened the sixth seal, I behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to earth, as a fig drops its leaf figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it was rolled up, and every mountain and every island was moved out of its place. I mean, get your head round this one. The blue sky, what we see, is going to rip open and roll back. Like, what are people going to do? Like, what are people going to do? What are people going to do when these stars all start falling to earth out of the sky? The sun is black as sackcloth and the moon is like blood. And the sky is rolling back and the sun and the moon get off. It says the sun and the moon are dumbfounded. They run away. What are people going to do? What are people going to do? Like, you can't even picture it. It's end of the simulation, mate. The computer game is ending. Movie reel ending. You know, like when it used to run out. The movie reel is running out, mate, and everyone's going to be like, oh, no. Like, it's serious. But what did he do? Listen to this, verse 15. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the commanders and the mighty men and the slave and the free men hid themselves in the caves and the rocks in the mountains. Well, you look all around the world today, And all of these politicians and multimillionaires and even the military are building what's called domes bases, deep underground military bunkers. They're building them under the seabed. There's billionaires. There's even guys there who says, ready for nuclear Armageddon, see inside the doomsday bunker. And we see how people are selling these bunkers. It says, business is booming for doomsday bunkers. Texas-based company claims sales have spiked 1,000%. You've got all these rich people buying all these bunkers and building all these deep underground military bases. But what is going to happen when they run into the hills? What does it say? They say, fall upon us, for the wrath of the warrior lamb. The wrath of the lamb has come, and the great day of wrath has come. Who is able to stand it? They're going to run into these places like foxholes, but the Lord's sending a nuclear weapon. It's like trying to hide yourself in a badger hole when a nuclear bomb is coming, mate. It's just not going to happen. They're running in these places, in these foxholes. This is what they're going to do in the end times. We see them all getting prepared now. They're all building these things now. People think, oh yeah, they're going to be all this third world war and the end of time and that. Well, I'll just build a bunker. And it's like, Revelation says they're going to do this. The book of Revelation says they're going to try and hide themselves in the rocks. But the warrior lamb is coming, mate. And these rocks are going to get disintegrated. Go ahead, sister.
This always comes to mind when you were speaking about the bunkers. And at the time, I wasn't aware of the scriptures that you were sharing. But it has stuck with me. I was in the States, and I was actually taken on a trip to Washington, D.C., which everyone knows is the capital. And whilst you're there, you notice there's cars, there's traffic lights, there's streets, there's people, but there's no shops, no news agents, no kiosks, no supermarkets, nothing above the ground. It's all underground. Mm-hmm. So you go around and you see cars, streets, people, cars, and there's no high street as such. It's all underground in the bunkers, and that was 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And obviously hairdressers, everything, everyday life goes on underground.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, it just was like, this is unusual. Obviously, Washington, D.C. is a target.
Yeah, well, they're building these things. Go ahead, bro.
Why don't they just go and live on one of the planets? They've conquered space. They've stepped on the moon. Just go and live on the moon. Oh, well, actually, it's all a bit of a lie, so we're going to go underground.
But when these stars fall from heaven and every continent and island has moved out of shape, every earthquake's blowing up and the seas are raging and turning and men's hearts fail them, as it says. They're all going to do it. Every apocalyptic movie you watch, they're all trying to get to it. The Antarctic bunker, this bunker, that bunker. The American government have built this bunker and they're all running for these bunkers, and it's the Wonka ticket to get in the bunker. But the Lord's just going to roll them back like a crisp packet. I mean, it's like, it's serious. The people can't hide from the wrath of the warrior lamb. So yeah, we see this on the rise, and this is new, you know, this is new. The people have been doing this. You can watch videos online. I watched one of these the other day. The super rich secret doomsday bunkers that are on the rise. They're trying to buy the bunkers, and you know, the sales are going through the roof. But Revelation tells us they're gonna run through the mountains and try and bury themselves in the rocks, saying the wrath of the lamb is here. Who can stand in it? And it's like, no one, mate. Why don't you just repent and just get to know him, fall in love with him, and he'll put a crown on your head and you'll be in with him for eternity. Like, it's a no-brainer. What's the good news? What does gospel mean? Gospel means good tellings. It means good news. What's the good news in this? Want some good news now? Amos 5:8. This is the good news, beloved. This is the resolve and the conclusion to all of this. Yeah, there's stars and cosmic powers and principalities, and there's planets in rebellion to God, and there's angelic hosts in the cosmos, and there's dragons whipping a tail, and Michael's doing a battle and this and that. But ultimately, we're told in Scripture what happens. He wipes away every tear from our eye. There won't even be a need for a sun and a moon, for Jehovah will be the light of the people. I mean, this is where we want to be. What's the good news? The good news is that we seek him who made all things. We find him and we get to know him now. What does the scriptures say? Do not harden your heart. Today, if you have heard his voice, do not harden your heart. Amos 5:8. Seek him that made the seven stars and Orion and turns the shadow of death into mourning And he makes the day dark with night, that calleth for the waters of the sea, and poureth them out upon the face of the earth. Jehovah, Yahweh is his name. Isn't that amazing? We've got to seek him who made all this, who told us the battle plan. He actually told us. I was sitting outside in the garden with Sonia, and we're going on about it, and she just stopped and she went, isn't it amazing? And isn't it just wonderful that he's shown us, though? I was like, wow, yeah. He's told us, like, this is my plan. He didn't even reveal it to angels, you know. It said that the angels wanted to know what this was. And he hid it from the angels, and we got told it. See, the angels can't be the bride. The angels want to be the bride, and they're not. That's what Satan got jealous for. And you all got that chance. Angels want to be you, but we want to be angels. It's so backward. It just shows the fallen state of who we are. We want all this power and knowledge, and we think cosmic clatters and spinning around. Whoa, whoa. But, you know, everyone's trying to get high and as a human, but the angels want to get low. They come to here to be like us. You know, they can't be the bride. You can. Hallelujah. Ephesians 4, verse 6. For there is one God, the Father of all, who is above all. Amen. He's above all the stars, all the planets. He's above it. He's above it. You can't hide him in a bunker either. You can't put him in a box. He's the most high, no matter how high we try and get. He's above all. James says this, and I think James was giving hints here. These cosmic creatures, the angels, the Decepticons. James 1, do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the heavenly Father of lights. So he's the father of these things, okay? With whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Wow, why does he use that word? No variation or shadow of turning. Remember, these things are all meant to be spinning round and this and that. Living in dark matter, black hole and that. From the Father, he's above, and he is the Father of delights. Don't be deceived. Get to know him now. And finally, the Gospel of Yeshua, in the Gospel of Luke, and the words of Yeshua, Luke 21. This is what the Messiah says when we see all these things. Now there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth the distress of nations. With perplexity, the sea and the waves shall roar. Men's hearts shall fail them for fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Okay, verse 28. Now when you see these things begin to happen, look up, because your redemption draws near. When they're all running to the hills, and they're running, and motorways are congested, and people are killing one another for a Wonka ticket to get in the Dumb's base, we're all going to just be outside, looking up, ready to meet him, mate. Just ready to meet him, like, whoa, you told me all this was happening. All the moon is shot, everything's going pee-tong. The sky's rolling back like a scroll, but wow, you are coming to get me, and I'm here. And the rest of the world are going to try and get underground. And they're trying to get, we're going to be looking up and waiting for them. Know what I mean? Okay. To end then, I just want to remind ourselves how we began. Because it is my belief that the Lord allowed certain authorities over certain countries and certain dignitaries over certain areas for the authorities to rule over them until the master returns. But for us, we're not ruled by angels, you know. The nations, they are actually ruled by fallen angels. We're not ruled by... God said, no, you're going to be my people. No angel is going to rule you. No fallen angel. You're mine. And therefore, this is what we should do. And we began with the judge, and we'll end with the judge. But I want to show how we need to put judgments in our own gates to avoid all of this deception from the fallen angels. You shall appoint judges and officers in all your gates, which the Lord your God gives you, according to your tribes, and you shall judge the people with just judgment. It's funny, isn't it? If you've ever heard that slogan, only God can judge me. It's like, hang on, Deuteronomy 16, the priests are judging you there, you know, be careful, good. Look, we're called to set up judges in our gates, and no longer do we dwell in that city, that geographical city, as our forefathers did. We're now the city, the temple of God. We need to set judges in our gates, in our eyes, in our ears. Amos 5:15, hate evil, love good, establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord your God of hosts will be gracious to the remnants of Joseph. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, beloved, hallelujah. And then we'll end just finally on the first verse. You shall not sacrifice to the Lord your God a bull or a sheep which has any blemish or defect, for it is abomination to the Lord. So I've named this the perfect broken sacrifice, because the sacrifice, the korban, would have to be broken. The death signified the death of our ego, the death of our flesh that we're putting to death. The beastly tendencies and the broken aspect of the animal represents our broken and contrite spirit, that we should have been in that place, but rather the Lord has made an atonement. So if you're looking for the perfect sacrifice to give to God, I want to know the perfect offering. Psalm 51 verse 17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. You want to know it. We can sing praise to God. We can bless him and tell him all the great things that he is. But the true, acceptable, appropriate offering is on your knees, prostrate. I'm a sinner. I'm a wretch. Forgive me, Lord. And he'll lift you back up and he'll say, I love you. That's how we do it, beloved. That's the proper sacrifice. That he doesn't want it without blemish, no spot, no wrinkle, no blemish. We've got to abstain from it. Our Messiah would have been able to see every inch of you that was crooked. Our Messiah would be able to see every sin that had ever embellished you, every demon that had ever entangled you, and every sin that you'd ever committed. But our Messiah seen you with a different lens. He seen me with a different lens. He looked at you with hope. He looked at you with prospect. He looked at your prophetic future. He didn't look at what the devil had made you. He was looking at you, of what he was going to make you. You know, he could look at you and he could spiritually discern in a moment your wretchedness. But Messiah, he looked at the righteousness that you would be in him. And we have to see each other with that same lens, beloved. We have to see the pearl that he sees. He did not see your decimation. He seen your destination. He did not see who you were in the world. He seen who you would be in the world to come. And this is how we have to see one another. We have to see the light and not the dark. We have to see the good and not the bad, beloved. Let us see ourselves with the image of God. Let us see ourselves the way he sees us. Brothers and sisters, let me remind you that we are made in that very image. We have been birthed into favour. We have been birthed into grace, birthed into the covenant. We have permission now, opportunity to walk out his covenant and wedding vows. Wow! And that's all gratified by the blood of the Lamb. Need I say any more? It's written, I'm a man of uncircumcised lips. I could go on about this all day. But look, it's written, beloved. I make no further claim of endeavour about this. It's the truth. This is what he sees in you. You know, I'm not making this up. This is written. You're the apple of his eye, his special treasure above all of the world. Do you know what a lapidist is? A lapidist is a person who polishes gems and jewels. It's called lapidary. And Jehovah is a lapidrist. He's collected his special treasure and he's polishing all of us, yeah? And he polishes us so that we shine brighter. A lapidist performs lapidary. He polishes his jewels so that they reflect more light and grow in value. And that's what he's done for you. The virtuous wife is a pearl. Who can find her? The Lord has found her. I'm here today to tell you that you are that bride. And when you're feeling like you're getting polished, it's just because he wants you to reflect more light and add more value. Don't forget it, beloved. Don't forget it. You know, we need to start to surrender to his perspective over us. Do you know what it means to surrender to his perspective over us? It's to feel so loved that you just want to explode. You've got to surrender to his perspective over you. You know, we shouldn't walk around with this overwhelming perspective of everything we're not. We need to walk round with the overwhelming concept of everything that he is. Are we walking around with that concept of everything that he is? Or are we walking around mishmash failure, this and that in the mud today? No, 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 that's not what he sees in you, beloved. Look, you've been paid for. Do you know what it means to be ransomed? It means there's a transaction took place. That means there's extraordinary value in you, beloved. Wow, that's what we got to see. Let's look at the price tag that we have. Because I'm telling you now, Jehovah did not get ripped off. He didn't get swindled. He gave his only begotten son. You were bought at a price, you're not your own. Therefore, glorify your body. That is your reasonable service. It's 101, beloved.
The pearl of great prize.
The pearl of great prize. You are the bride. And I've come to call you to be beautiful. Dance and shine, beloved bride. Dance and shine. For your beauty shall occupy the aisle of heaven and the angels will come and watch. The angels are going to come and watch you be betrothed to Yeshua. And you're going to be in the wedding feast and they're all going to watch you. What a responsibility. Let that be of serious understanding and most serious importance, because it should be the only thing that matters in this life. And we end Deuteronomy 16 verse 20. You shall follow what is altogether just. How do we follow what is altogether just? We follow the footsteps of our Messiah. We follow his footsteps as we dance with him in that last dance. He who says he knows him shall walk as he walk. My sheep know me and they follow me. Let us follow Yeshua all the way to the end and eternity. Let's pray. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Father God, we just thank you, Lord, that you have bought us and redeemed us at a price, Lord. Thank you, Father, that we are just a treasure to you, Lord, and angels became jealous of it, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have chosen us before the foundation of the world. How can we ever repay you, Lord? We're told, let us be a living sacrifice. It's our reasonable service. So, Father, help us to walk out your ways and your covenant. Help us to be obedient because you love us, Lord, and you want us for eternity. You want us so badly for eternity, Lord, and you're going to do everything you can to make that happen. So the trials and the tests, that's just the bride trying to fit into a dress, Lord. Help us meet that expectation, Father, we pray, through the power of your Son, Yeshua. Lord, we bless you, we love you, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, and we just admire you for who you are. We want to wait for your coming. We know you're going to arrive in style, Lord. We know that you're going to arrive in style. We bless you, Father. We're looking forward to meeting you. Amen.
Amen.